Welcome to the ever-changing world of sports. An interesting world indeed it is. This is WTV Sports Center. Always a pleasure to be your host. My name is Elijah Mwangi. Now we have a great show lined up for you. We are going to tell you what exactly happened last week. Volleyball team is the talk of the town, and perhaps Lungaho, their head coach, is perhaps the happiest person we have in the world after he beat Algeria in Safaricom Indoor Arena at Kasarani. And the team is headed for greater things in Mexico. So we have that and more stories lined up for you. And also Harambee Stars in Ethiopia. Now, that's quite a tricky story to execute because many critics have argued that's not news, because we are sometimes so much used to such kind of a loss. Harambee Stars lost to Ethiopia 2-0. But either way, we also have other stories from the international front when it comes to the world of football, including the player of the week and rumor has it segment. So keep it WTV. But first things first, let's have a look at the top stories we have today. Welcome to the program. We start our show with some good news because the women of volleyball team is the best in Africa. Yes, it's official. And Lungaho just clinched his fifth title victory at Kasarani last weekend. And the team seems to be headed to great heights in Mexico. So at this point, let's have a look at how that action unfolded after the team took its ninth title at Kasarani.
After successfully defending their title at the African Nations Championship, the national women's volleyball team left for Mexico on Tuesday night for the World Grand Prix. This is the second time Kenya is taking part in the global event held annually and which brings together the best teams from across the world. Kenya has been pulled in Group 3 alongside Algeria, Australia, Colombia, Cuba, Kazakhstan, Mexico and Peru. Kenya performed poorly in the last year's tournament, but coach David Lungaho says they will put up a better performance this year as they have a better understanding of their opponents. Lungaho has retained all the 12 players who did Kenya proud during the African Nations Cup at the weekend. The National Oil Corporation sponsored team will face their group opponents in two legs, the first competition beginning Thursday in Mexico against Peru, Colombia and host Mexico. They will then head to Algeria on June 30th for their next group challenge, where they will come up against hosts Algeria, Mexico and Australia from July 1st to 5th. If the team finishes among the top four teams, they will travel to Australia for the finals scheduled for July 10th to 12th.
And now shifting gears to matters football here in the country. Just after many Kenyans had placed their hopes with the Kenya national football team, that is Harambee Stars, after they got a draw with Congo during the AFCON 2017 qualifiers, now the trend is changing and the question of what is ailing the Kenyan football team is emerging again after they lost 2-0 to Ethiopia in Addis Ababa. Now this places the head coach Bob Williamson in a very tricky situation. Will he take Harambee Stars to the next level?
As much as patriotic Kenyans always hope that the Stars will shine in their assignments, the bitter truth is that most of the times, their hopes fade away with every encounter. Harambee Stars lost 2-0 to Ethiopia in a Chan qualifier match on Sunday. While many critics have argued that this was not a surprise, with some claiming that the team needs to be groomed with time. It's such critics that have given the Harambee Stars head coach Bob Williamson sleepless nights as he tries to calculate the next move. Williamson admitted after the Chan qualifiers game in Addis Ababa that Kenya is now faced with a tall order to advance to the next stage of the competition. The result is a big loss for Kenya in their quest to play in Chan finals next year and come just a week after the team did well to hold Congo Brazzaville away in the opening match of 2017 Africa Cup of Nations qualifiers. Harambee Stars will need to win return leg by a 3-goal margin to be sure of making it to the next round of the competition.
Last weekend, it was all systems go at Austria Grand Prix. And this time round, things were a bit different because Nico Rosberg came in a bit strong to beat Lewis Hamilton, who has maintained the lead for quite some time. Let's have a look at how that action unfolded.
Nico Rosberg took a dominant victory in the Austrian Grand Prix to reduce Mercedes teammate Lewis Hamilton's lead in the World Championship. Rosberg passed Hamilton at the start and controlled the race to the end. Hamilton's attempt to repass on lap 1 was thwarted by the safety car triggered by a heavy crash between Ferrari's Kimi Raikkonen and McLaren's Fernando Alonso. McLaren ended up on top of the Ferrari, but both drivers ran hard. Alonso, who had slid along the top of the barrier before the cars came to a halt, described the incident as scary. The crash, which appeared to be caused by Raikkonen losing control of his car under power while Alonso was alongside on his outside, was investigated by stewards after the race, but no further action was taken. When the race restarted, Hamilton tracked Rosberg to their only pit stops. Rosberg's third victory of the season reduces his deficit to Hamilton to 10 points after the world champion extended it by winning the previous race in Canada.
Still on football matters, but across the borders in South America, the Copa America is on its top gear, and now the big Catalan giants, Chile versus Uruguay, are taking on each other at quarterfinals level. But also a big team to watch this time round is Argentina, and not forgetting that Lionel Messi is part of that great team. Let's have a look at the going down there in South America.
If Brazil is to claim the fifth Copa America title in the last seven tournaments dating back to 1997, it's going to have it without the services of top player Neymar. Neymar was involved in a post-match incident after his team lost 1-0 to Colombia in their second group game and was suspended for 4 matches, the rest of the tournament. Neymar decided to leave the squad after his suspension, as training with the squad without being able to play was not going well with him. Void was filled by Hoffenheim forward Roberto Firmino, who looks poised to join one of the top-spending clubs in Europe in the near future. Firmino, who is 23, scored in a 2-1 win over Venezuela in the group finale and has 4 goals in 9 caps with the senior team. Brazil takes on Paraguay on Saturday the 27th. Important to note is that Paraguay had a nightmare World Cup qualifying, finishing bottom after qualifying for the previous 4 tournaments, but has rebounded under new manager Ramon Diaz in this tournament. Paraguay defeated Jamaica, drew with Argentina and Uruguay to reach the quarters. Paraguay has won the tournament twice.
This time round on Sports Center, it seems like we have a lot of football stories. Yes, because now we are crossing over to Canada, where we have the Women's World Cup getting to the home stretch. And the only hope that Africa had, that is Cameroon, the dream was shattered because it was eliminated by China. And now everyone is on the big teams like Germany to see whether they will take the trophy.
China booked their place into the quarterfinals of the Women's World Cup with a 1-0 win over Cameroon at the Commonwealth Stadium on Saturday. On the other side, FIFA Women's World Cup holders Japan are into the quarterfinals after goals in each half were enough for a 2-1 win over Netherlands. Japan controlled the contest and possession from the first minute, with the Dutch struggling for ideas at times against the organized defense. Netherlands did have an early salvo from a Sherida Spitze, which flew over the bar from 20 meters. This weekend, Australia takes on Japan in Edmonton, while England faces Canada in Vancouver. The 2015 FIFA Women's World Cup is the 7th, and in March 2011, Canada won the right to host the event. The first time the country will host the tournament, and the third time it has been in North America. The 2015 tournament saw the World Cup expanded to 24 teams from 16 in 2011. The 2015 tournament is also using goal line technology for the first time with the Hawkeye system.
And now moving on to our rumor has it segment, we focus on Karim Benzema, the Real Madrid's best striker. And it's rumored that he's going to Arsenal. And everyone is asking, will this move really boost Arsenal's standings come next season? Is he the man that will take Arsenal to the lifting of the trophy next season? Let's find out.
Arsenal have made Karim Benzema their top transfer target after Arsene Wenger requested his signing. However, Benzema, who looks increasingly likely to be leaving Real Madrid this summer, is being monitored by Manchester United and Liverpool. Peter Cech's move across London is imminent after a fee was agreed between Chelsea and Arsenal. Arsenal have agreed a total of £10.9 million fee for Chelsea goalkeeper Peter Cech, according to Sky sources. The fee was one of the key elements outstanding as Arsenal edged closer to finalising the transfer of Czech Republic international. It is understood that Cech has already agreed personal terms in principle with Arsenal, but no final deal has been announced by either club. If the deal goes through as is now expected worldwide, Cech would be eligible for Arsenal's first game of the season, the Community Shield, on August 2nd, when their opponents will be the Premier League champions, Chelsea.
To our Player of the Week segment, this time round we celebrate our very own Africa star Didier Drogba, the Ivorian international, and his career at Chelsea, that is Stamford Bridge, is arguably one of the best career that a footballer can wish for.
Didier Drogba is an Ivorian professional footballer who plays for the English club Chelsea as a striker and is the all-time top scorer and former captain of the Ivory Coast national team. He is best known for his career at Chelsea, for whom he has scored more goals than any other foreign player, and is currently the club's fourth highest goal scorer of all time. In October 2012, he was voted by Chelsea supporters as the club's greatest ever player. He has also been named African Footballer of the Year twice, winning the accolade in 2006 and 2009. After playing in youth games, Drogba made his professional debut aged 18 for League 2 club Limams and signed his first professional contract aged 21 years. After finishing the 2002-2003 season with 17 goals in 34 appearances for Ligue 1 side, he moved to Olympique de Marseille, where he finished as the third highest goal scorer in 2003-2004 season with 19 goals and helped the club reach the 2004 UEFA Cup final. In the summer of 2004, Drogba moved to Chelsea for a club record of £24 million, making him the most expensive Ivorian player in history. In his debut season, he helped the club win their first league title in 50 years, and a year later he won another Premier League title.
Wow, that's Didier Drogba for you, and we can only wish him the very best, especially at this point in time when he's getting to the point of home stretch in his football career. Now at this point, we take a short break, but don't go far, because in a short while, my colleague Steve Durango will be joining me right here to discuss some of the top stories that we've highlighted. Keep it WTV. Thank you very much, and we are glad that you are still watching WTV. This is the second segment where we analyze some of the top stories that we've discussed, from football to rugby. And also now the talk of the town is a volleyball team with Elunga. Well, now to just bring us to speed with the latest happenings in across many fields, I have my colleague Steve joining me right now. Thank you so much for finding time for us.
Thank you, Elijah. Always a pleasure being here.
Now, I don't know where to start, but now the latest talk of town is about the volleyball team. What do you think about their performance last weekend?
Well, the performance was brilliant. They won all the games in that tournament, and they won all three sets in each game. That is splendid. That is something that has not been seen before here in Kenya. So I think they really outdid themselves. They really made us proud as Kenyans, and I think it was a good surprise for Kenya, who have not really been performing very well in the recent past to do with sports. So they really uplifted our spirits. You could see the cabinet secretary Hassan Wario was there celebrating with the rest of the 8,000 Kenyans. Imagine that, 8,000 Kenyans fitted in that gymnasium. That shows that how many people really wanted them. They were rooting for them to win, and that they did. They did not disappoint the Kenyans.
Okay, well, you've talked of, you know, the cabinet secretary being there at one point, but, you know, critics say that, you know, Malkia, or whether the African queens, have not been in the past being treated with the right, you know, with the right measure, so to speak, because they are African champions. But at one point we see, yes, national oil is there.
Yeah.
But critics feel that, you know, something has to be done. Are you satisfied with the treatment that the African champions have received so far?
I think we have a long way to go when it comes to appreciating our sportsmen and women. I think we should be able to take them as highly as we take probably our legislators. So I think we have a long way to go. They're being treated. Finally, they have a sponsor. They didn't have a sponsor before. They have National Oil on board, and we can see that how far, you know, having a sponsor has taken them. They've won the 9th title for Kenya. So I think we should have more sponsors, not only the government, but more of the private sector players coming in to sponsor these teams as they go into many of these tournaments. And I think that's the only way we can go forward. That's the only way that we can be able to register such impeccable results.
Ah, well, nice. And of course, now that's volleyball, but we've had football and other games as well, which are really struggling to get the right footing. So what do you think we can pick from that splendid performance from the African Queens?
Well, I think what we can really pick from the African Queens is the amount of preparation that they put in their game. They make sure that they train every time. They're always in camp. You can remember every time that we are going to Kasarani, we always meet with the Janet Wanjas as they come into the gymnasium to practice, to make sure that their game is on point. And you could see the results last weekend here at, when they were here at the Safaricom Kasarani Gymnasium. You can see that those are the results of hard work. Hard work always pays, and that's the only way we should go for all the rest of the sports that we have in the country.
And what do you expect from there? Because it's not the end of the road yet. A lot is installed. So what are your predictions when they go for the next matches?
Well, they're heading off to Mexico, I think. Mexico for the Grand Prix of the volleyball. I think they will put on a good fight. They will put on a good fight. Remember last year, during the Olympics, we were unable to reach the Olympics. We were crushed by the North Africans, the Tunisia. Tunisia beat us at home. So I'm sure they are going into this tournament with a point to prove that they are not only champions in Africa, but they are also champions in the world. So I think, I hope the very best for them as they head over to Mexico, and I hope they win all the games just like they did here in Kenya.
Indeed, congratulations Ainoda for a job well done for the Kenya women volleyball team. And as Kenyans, we can only wish them the very best. Still now on sports, and looking at, you know, football, the other side, because we have good news concerning volleyball, but now for football is sad news. And remember, you can always join in this conversation using the hashtag SportsCenter. Our Twitter handle is WTVKE, and our Facebook page is WTV Kenya. But now let's go to the international front, to the South America, where we have Copa America, you know, on the top notch. And first, maybe I should start by asking, where are you placing your money and maybe why? That should be the first question.
Well, I always place my money on Argentina, probably not for the last World Cup because I was supporting Germany. But anyway, I think Argentina is a really good team. If you really look at the composition of the team, it's very complete. It has, like, a very good balance of the players from the goalkeeper to the striker, and they also have one important factor that is Lionel Messi. Having the best player in the world in your team gives you an advantage in any tournament. So I think they have the upper hand against most teams. Probably their competition would be Uruguay or Chile.
Talking of Uruguay, and maybe you can also comment about their lineup, because that's one team that shattered Africa's dream. You know, you remember the 2010 World Cup in South Africa, and Ghana lost. You know, during the, you know, So, do you think Uruguay has an edge?
Well, Uruguay, despite having Suarez and Cavani, not many other players, probably the defense with the guys from Atletico Madrid. But so far, I think Argentina has proved that they are a force to reckon with. They are winning games. They have not lost a single game in this tournament. So I think it will be a really tall order to beat Argentina, especially with Lionel Messi. I don't think so. Maybe Brazil, and Neymar is out now because of the red card. So I think for now, my money is on Argentina all day, any day.
Oh, and of course, just to bring you to speed, Copa America is an equivalent of AFCON here in Africa. So it's only that in South America, football is on another level. And that's why maybe it's getting a lot of publicity at this particular point. Now, winding up, we must talk about the Austria Grand Prix. Because this time, you know, Lewis Hamilton had it rough from, you know, Nico Rosberg. What's your take on Formula One, that is Austria Grand Prix?
Well, Nico Rosberg has been a thorn in the flesh for Lewis Hamilton for a long time. Being that they're in the same team, the Mercedes-Benz team, they're really competing to make sure one stays at the top. Every one of them wants to remain the top driver for Mercedes-Benz team. And this loss really doesn't come as a surprise to me, because there's that competition. Even last season, before Lewis Hamilton was able to take the title at the end of the season, you could see that there was a lot of competition coming from Nico Rosberg. And I think this race, probably it was a faulty performance from Lewis Hamilton. I think he'll come back stronger for the next leg of the race. Remember, he has three consecutive wins in the Formula One so far, in the Formula One season. So I think that was just a blip for Nico Rosberg.
Wow, we've been speaking to Steve Durango, one of the sports writers here at WTV, basically to put matters into perspective concerning some of the top stories that we've been having all week long. And now, from Steve and I, it's a wrap here at WTV Sports Center. Remember, you can always send us feedback. Our Twitter handle is the WTVKE and our Facebook page is WTV Kenya. Till next time, have a sporting weekend.